Today, you hear the word MCP everywhere. On X, YouTube, in your dev groups, even when you open the fridge. MCP, some say it's the future. Others call it the new API. One thing is clear, MCP is trending and everyone is talking about it. But what exactly MCP is? Where did it come from? What's its story and how do we actually use it? So, first things first. MCP stands for Model Context Protocol. It's a new standard designed especially for AI models and especially for large language models or LLMs like GPT, Claude, DeepSeek and others. Before diving into the technical side, let's take a quick step back and see how we even got here. In late 2022, OpenAI launched ChatGPT, probably the most talked about AI at the time. Since then, new players like Claude AI, DeepSeek, and Gemini entered the scene. Initially, these models were impressive, but they mainly worked by predicting the next word based on the training data. In tech fields, we used them mostly for generating code, fixing bugs, writing test cases, and so on and so forth. Then things evolved. We started giving AIs context, real-world information through APIs. For example, Gemini could access your Gmail to read and reply to emails. These integrations were called tools or functions, allowing AI to interact with apps and services. Imagine you want an AI to automate customer support. The AI needs to read the emails, answer simple questions like how do I reset my password, and send replies all without human intervention. To make this happen, what you need to do? You'd usually hire a developer to code a solution connecting the AI to Gmail's API, but every developer might build it differently. These custom integrations are hard to scale and hard to maintain. This is exactly where MCP comes in. MCP, as explained before, Model Context Protocol, is a universal standard that defines how APIs can interact with external tools. Think of it like USB-C. Before USB-C, every device needs its own cable. Now, one cable can charge your laptop, phone, headphones, even connect external monitors. MCP aims to be the USB-C for AI. It creates a plug-and-play system where any AI model, like GPT, Claude, DeepSeek, Gemini, or whatever's next, can instantly connect to APIs, tools, databases, and applications in a standardized way. Let me give you some facts. MCP was introduced on November 25th, 2024, few months ago, based on when you are watching this video, of course, but it was introduced few months ago by Anthropic, which is the creators of Claude AI. It standardizes the way AI models understand available tools, choose actions, and perform tasks without custom hard coding, which is really great. It makes it easier to chain multiple tools together and build a complex workflow dynamically. Here's the official announcement if you want to dive deeper. So let's have a quick look on it all together. So here it was, as I mentioned, introduced on November 25, 2025, 2024. And here today we're open sourcing the MCP or Model Context Protocol, a new standard for connecting AI assistant to the system with data lives, including content repositories and so on and so forth. So I will not just go ahead and read this one. I will let you read it on your own. Now, let's dive into the topic and let me explain what I said before. Think back to the early days, maybe it was GPT-3 or 3.5, I don't really remember exactly, but if you opened a basic chatbot and asked it to send you an email, just a simple task, just send an email to someone, it simply couldn't. At best, it would tell you, sorry, I can't do that. Without any help, the most an LLM can do is answer questions or maybe tell you about some historical figure and that's about it. There is no real action happening. When I say meaningful, I mean talking about real-world tasks, sending email, booking a meeting, doing actual work. But LLMs, by design, they're mainly just prediction engines. Their code still is guess what text should come next, all right? And that's it. That's the extent of what an LLM can do solo. Now, the real breakthrough came when developers and engineers realized they could hook LLMs up to external tools. Think of a tool like an API, something that lets the LLM reach outside its own little bubble. Take Perplexity AI as an example. When you chat with it, it's not just making things up. It actually goes out, searches the internet, grabs real information, and brings it back to you. But remember, the LLM isn't magically doing that by itself. Behind the scenes, developers built a system that lets the LLM access external services. And there are tons of services like this: Brave Search, OpenAI Browsing, APIs, and more. The moment we gave LLM access to tools, they instantly became more powerful. Here's another simple example. Imagine you want a spreadsheet to update automatically whenever you get a new email. Normally, you'd use something like Zapier N8N or a similar automation tool. Now, if you connect an LLM to that automation, it suddenly becomes capable of handling real tasks. Way cooler, right? But here's the catch. Things get complicated fast. The more you want your assistant to do, search the web, check emails, summarize documents, the more you end up duct taping different tools together. And trust me, managing all these integrations become a nightmare. This is exactly why we don't have the Jarvis, you know, Jarvis from Iron Man. It's not because LLMs are not smart enough, but it's because making dozens of tools work together smoothly and is insanely difficult. So this is where we're at today. First, we had LLM that could write a poem or tell you about World War I. Then we leveled up connecting them to tools and external services. But now the bottleneck isn't the LLM anymore. It's how frustrating and messy it is to build reliable systems around them. So let me resume and explain what I just mentioned so we don't go further and like we don't get lost. So here we have the phase one of LLMs or AI, which is like predicting the next word and generating answers based on training data. And as I mentioned before, it's not something that which is really insane, but it's just generating something based on training data, all right? Which is cool at the time, but then this LLM is not capable of really doing a real action. So it cannot send an email, it cannot read data from your laptop. There are no real actions that an LLM can do, just prediction engines, all right? And then we move to the phase two. So the phase two is when we started to give LLMs and AI tools and AI applications more context. So think of it this way. So here we have LLM and you have a bunch of tools. So we provide more context and data to the LLM. And in this example, for example, we took Gemini. So Gemini as an LLM, we gave it the power or the context to access your Gmail account, to access your calendar, and so on and so forth. So when you ask Gemini to create or to book a new appointment or to add a meeting in your calendar, it has already the Google Calendar API, so it can interact with it. The same for Gmail and any other tool related to Gemini or Gemini can access too. In other words, this is how it works. So we have AI application 1, 2, and 3, and we have custom API integration, and each custom API integration is connected to some API, which is, for example, calendar API, mailing API, or any other API. So it's capable and able for doing things, but based on the context that we provided. But here, the problem, as I mentioned before, is when we want to scale. When we want to scale, it really becomes a nightmare. And then we move to the phase three, which is the MCP era, all right? So, but before moving and like diving too much into the diagram, let me explain to you and like give you a small introduction and an easy one about MCP. Imagine every tool you want to connect to your LLM speaks a completely different language. Tool 1 speaks English, Tool 2 speaks Spanish, and Tool 3 speaks Japanese. You get the idea, right? So now it's not that we don't have standards for how APIs works. We do. But the reality is, every service provider designs their APIs a little differently. Each one asks for different data, has different ways, you need to authenticate different rules you have to follow, and so on and so forth. It ends up feeling like you're just duct taping a bunch of different systems together. Can you make it work? Sure, but once you try to scale it, it becomes a real headache. And that's where MCP comes in. You can think of MCP as a translation layer that sits between your LLM and these outside tools and services. It speaks one unified language that the LLM can easily understand. So instead of the LLM having to figure out English, Spanish, Japanese separately, MCP handles the translation and presents everything in a way that's super clear for the LLM. This is basically the next step beyond just LLM and tools. It makes connecting to external resources much simpler and much more reliable. Because at the end of the day, that's all tools are: outside sources. And with MCP in place, your LLM can, for example, connect directly to a database. You could literally just say, hey, create a new entry in my database. And thanks to MCP, the LLM would know exactly how to do it. Without MCP, in the previous setup where it's just LLMs plus tools, you need a lot of manual work. You had to carefully plan each step, handle a bunch of edge cases, and constantly monitor things to make sure nothing broke. So think about a really simple setup. You want your LLM to read your new email and send you a text notification. Sounds easy, right? But there is a catch. What happens when Google or any other email provider updates their API? Suddenly, your whole chain of automation can break. And if you've built something complex, it can quickly spiral into total mess. And this is why, even in the world of LLMs, great engineers are still absolutely necessary. So don't worry, guys, about your jobs. You still have jobs, or we still have jobs. Because building and maintaining things, or like maintaining these systems, is hard, and it only gets harder as you scale. So what MCP does is smooth all of that out. It creates a consistent bridge between your LLM and the services you wanted to interact with, making the communication between them clean, stable, and reliable. So now let's dive a little deeper into how the MCP ecosystem actually works. You have 4 main pieces: the MCP client, the MCP protocol, and the MCP server, and the external service. So let's break them out. So here we have our MCP client, which can be any MCP client like Cloud Desktop, IDE, like Cursor, or even a tool. All right. And then here we have the MCP protocol, which is the protocol used to communicate between your MCP server and MCP client. And then the MCP server connects and communicates with an external service. So the MCP protocol is the two-way communication channel between the client and the server. So as you can see here, this is how we communicate between the client and the server. Like, the MCP server's job is to take an external service, whether a database, an API, or whatever, and translate what it can do into a format the client can understand. So this is why that MCP protocol connection is so important. It keeps everything synced up between the client and the server. All right, so now I guess the story is clear and you know what MCP is, how it works, and the story behind it. Now, I guess the next step is that you subscribe to my channel and join me, and also enable the notifications so you will be notified every time I publish a new video. But the most important thing is what I will be doing for the next videos. So the next video, we will have our hands on these MCP servers. So we will build our own MCP server and we will see how it works. Also, we will integrate some ready to use MCP servers and so on and so forth. So like we will understand the story really deep technically. So stick to this video and don't forget to subscribe to my channel and wait for the next one. So if this is the first time you hear about MCP, or if I helped you understand what MCP is and what is this trend that everyone is talking about, just comment MCP below. Also, don't forget to check all the links that I will be adding to the description of this video so you get to know more about MCPs, MCP servers, and all this stuff. Thank you so much for watching and see you the next time.